Praise God. Praise God. Let the people of God say amen. Amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, a Bible teaching program where we edify, we exalt, and we challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to salvation through the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we are going to do the last part of our three-part series. We started with our internal enemy, the flesh, that is our natural proclivity to sin. Then, the last lesson we did, unmasking our external enemy, which is the world's values. And today we are going to talk about uncovering our eternal enemy, the devil. I hate that being so much. Oh my goodness. So today we are talking about the devil, and the case study is Nehemiah. And a short reading is Acts chapter 5, verse 13 to 21. Acts 5. 13 to 21, let us pray. Dear good God, through our Lord Jesus Christ, by the Holy Spirit, we thank you. Thank you for being our faithful, caring, loving, guiding Father. Oh, what a blessing. What a privilege to have you as a Father. And we want to give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. Sweet, blessed Holy Spirit, we ask that through this lesson, you glorify Jesus in my life and in the life of those who will be watching and listening. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Our foundation text is Genesis chapter 34. Verse 9 to 10, Genesis, I went to the wrong spot, 34, chapter 9, we are going to start at verse 10, from verse 9 to verse 10, pardon me. And there's a background to that foundation text. It's when the men of Shechem, they came to Jacob to ask for the hand of Dinah, his daughter, in marriage after she had been raped by the king's son of the city. And so they came that we know our son did the wrong thing, but he really loved this girl, and we would like to have our son marry her. Meanwhile, God had warned the Israelites not to intermarry with the Canaanites. So let's go to our foundation text. And make marriages with us. These are the people of Shechem now talking to Jacob and his sons. Give your daughters to us and take our daughters to yourselves. So you shall dwell with us, and the land shall be before you. Dwell and trade in it, and acquire possessions for yourselves in it. You see. So it's like kumbaya. Let's be together, one big happy family. There's nothing wrong with that, is there? But we'll soon see. How can we recognize our eternal enemy? Number one. The devil appears peaceful. I know that will throw a lot of people off, but please listen. The devil likes for us to think that he is violent and evil. Of course he is. Those are spiritual truths. But he doesn't want us to know that he actually, for the most part, walks quietly, stealthily. The devil's way of operating, please listen up, is mostly peaceful in the physical. Oh, the devil will not come to you first time like coming with a fight. Oh, no. The devil will tell you, we are people of peace. We don't cause trouble. The result of this so-called peaceful way, however, always bring calamities. We are going somewhere, please. Sambalat, Tobiah, and Geshem, the Arab, sent a word of peace to Nehemiah, asking him for a peace meeting. Had Nehemiah answered, they would have killed him there. You see, that's the exact way the devil operates. God commanded the Israelites to utterly destroy the Canaanites and not be at peace with them, lest the Canaanites turn the hearts of the Israelites away from the true God, you see. Instead, watch this. The Israelites intermarried with them and made peace with them. The result has been disastrous for the Jewish nation ever since. That's what you have today. Seriously. That is the problem we have in the Middle East today. You see. The book of Psalm, chapter 5, verse 9, Psalm 5, verse 9 says, for there is no faithfulness in their mouth. Their inward part is pure wickedness. Their throat is an open sepulchre. They flatter with their tongue. Listen, please. Anytime anybody is asking you to make peace that is contrary to what the Bible stands for, know that is the devil asking you to sign a demonic, satanic peace accord. I love Dr. Rogers the way he said it. It's better we are divided by the truth than be united in a lie, you see. The way of peace without God's kind of peace is a lie of ease from the Prince of Ills. The Bible says we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So if the peace they're asking you does not have the blood of Jesus in it, does not have the person of Jesus in it, as the only way to salvation, that is no peace. The way of peace without God's kind of peace is the lie of ease from the Prince of Ills. Moving on. Another way you will know if the devil is the one tempting you, apart from bringing peace, another way is the devil applies persecution. I believe an average Christian, we have understanding of this. When the devil notices that by divine wisdom, a believer refused to fall for his fake peace, for which he's an advocate, the devil begins to persecute the believer. Satan uses people and circumstances to apply persecution against the children of God. Examples, oh my goodness, I can go on. Asia Bibi in Pakistan, Leah Sharibu with Boko Haram, Pastor Andrew Bunsen in Turkey, all our brothers and sisters in China, in Saudi Arabia, all over the world, really, Russia, and even in the United States, who are being persecuted because of their biblical view, because of their biblical stand. Time will fail me to start mentioning names. But examples abound in Christians who live in fear for their lives in different countries where Christianity, believe it or not, is a crime. You see, after Nehemiah refused to have a sit down with Tobiah and Sanballat for their so-called peace meeting, Tobiah began to send threatening letters to Nehemiah and was sending letters to everybody, all the nobles and the princes in Jerusalem. He began to fire them with letters to frighten Nehemiah. A great persecution arose to the disciples in Jerusalem and scattered the church at Jerusalem after several failed threats and warnings from the Pharisees to silence the apostles from preaching the gospel, you see. There were so many instances. There was one, the soldiers they sent could not touch them. They just said, can you please come with us, please? Because the people were watching, and the people would have stoned the soldiers to death, you see. And there was one, they said, don't you preach again. But when that wouldn't work, they moved from verbal threat to physical threat, you see, to physical persecution. Romans 8:37. If you are a believer that is being persecuted in your family, in your workplace, in your country, please, please listen to me. Romans 8:37. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him, through our Lord Jesus Christ, who loves us. We are more than conquerors. Let's hang in there. Our captain is never derelict of duty. He's always leading us to victory. Amen. Our resolution will drown Satan's persecution if we stick to God's admonition. Our resolution will drown Satan's persecution if we stick to God's admonition. Moving on. When the devil tries persecution, like he's doing right now in China with our brothers and sisters, and instead of Christians reducing in number, they are now in their millions. So when the devil tries that and persecution fails, then he moves to the third phase, which is the worst and its most potent tool. He advances prostitution. And we're talking spiritual prostitution. Please follow me. Another word for this is corruption. The devil does not forgive nor forget anyone who has tagged as his enemy. Oh no. When peace and persecution fail to convert an individual to the devil's side, the devil puts up his most vicious and most successful trick. The slime of Satan's prostitution is what has diluted and changed, please listen up, the face of Christianity to what it is today. Excuse me. And the result has successfully confused those who are outside of Christianity. You see, when a Christian, please listen up as a believer, a child of God, when you are being offered some kind of rewards in exchange for quitting speaking biblical truth, that is spiritual prostitution. When you, as a child of God, who hold strongly to biblical view, when you are being advised to agree with other beliefs or values which are contrary to the Bible, that we all serve the same God, there are so many paths to God, so many ways to heaven, just agree with them. When you are being told to do that, that is spiritual prostitution from the devil. Balaam was destroyed because he fell for the spiritual prostitution extended to him by Balak, the king of Moab, in the case of children of Israel, you see. Balak said, I'm going to give you lots of gold, lots of treasures. Just come, curse these Israelites for me. Because whatever you say, it happens. And because Balaam couldn't just walk away from the promised gold and money and all that, even though God twisted his tongue literally, he wanted to curse, but he began to bless Israel. Then he taught Balak what to do. He said, just throw your girls, let them go into their camps, and let them do adultery and fornication with them. God himself will fight against them. And about 23,000, I believe, were killed for that at the Baal of Peor, you see. And so eventually, Balaam himself was destroyed. Why? Because he couldn't just walk away from the gold and from the treasures, because he turned into a prostitute, a spiritual prostitute, instead of a prophet. Had Nehemiah agreed to meet with Sanballat and Tobiah, he would have corrupted his own character, you see. You see, sometimes you don't even have to take gifts or exchange of something before you are corrupted. I remember the case of a pastor, very sad, just because he didn't use enough wisdom to know where to speak with an opposite sex, an opposite gender. And this news began to fly that he touched me inappropriately on my shoulder. And that man could have, if he were somebody like me that talks a lot with his hands, maybe he was trying to make an emphasis and touch that person, you see. But because there was no third party in that room, there was no way he could defend himself. He resigned from his post because he didn't want to drag the name of God into the mud, you see. So even by talking to the wrong person in the wrong place, in the wrong place, or the right person in the wrong place, that alone can corrupt you without you doing anything. So we have to be wise as Christians. So had Nehemiah gone to that meeting alone, without doing anything, just showing up at the meeting, that would have corrupted his character. Because these two characters over here, Sanballat and Tobiah, they were not known for anything good in Jerusalem, you see. And the spiritual integrity of the assignment that God gave Nehemiah would have been compromised as well, you see. When the character of the man of God has been maligned, the work of God is doing is equally gone, you see. But Nehemiah knew that Sanballat and Tobiah have no heritage or right or memorial in Jerusalem. He knew these people, they were not good people. They don't belong to the stock of Israel. So he didn't even waste his time. Listen, please. When somebody is asking you, let's go somewhere, let's go talk, and there's not going to be a third party, for whatever reason, as a Christian, you just decline. Don't let them rope you in. Decline. Agree to meet with them in a public place. Agree to have a third or fourth party, two people present. You see, we need to guard against, these are the things that the devil is using to make Christians look bad, you see. But how many people are you going to explain yourself to that I didn't do what they're accusing me of? I didn't compromise my stand, you see. So Nehemiah knew that these two, they were not good, so he didn't meet them. He did not involve them in an assignment that was dedicated to the God of Israel. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 13, verse 20. Proverbs 13, 20. He that walks with wise men shall be wise, Listen up, please. But a companion of fools shall be destroyed. Did you see that? May we not be foolish in Jesus' name. May we not walk with foolish people. We as believers, we have a target sign on our backs. And the devil is always looking for ways to get us. Unbiblical absorption of any kind, we eventually end up in corruption of all kinds. Unbiblical absorption of any kind, we eventually end up in corruption of all kinds. How can we overcome our enemy, the devil? There's only one way: resist. The Bible doesn't say we should run. If it's something about our natural inclination to sin, the Bible says run. If it's from the world system, they are trying to conform us, the Bible says refuse. But if it's coming from the devil, the Bible says resist. The devil is a bully. The Bible is very clear about how we should respond to our eternal enemy. And he's an eternal enemy because he's never going to like us from here to eternity. And the devil is not going, he doesn't like the sinners too, you see. He's an eternal enemy to everybody. But the enmity becomes pronounced when you become a child of God. We should stay and fight. That's the only way to beat a bully. When I was in the school system as a teacher, I always tell those who are victims of bullying, listen, bullies they are cowards themselves on the inside. And they have something that they don't like about themselves, but they are trying to take it out on you. So don't run away from bullying. You stay, okay? I used to tell my students that. So bullies, they are cowards on the inside. The Bible says we should stay and fight. We resist the devil based on the word of God, never in our own power. Oh no, please. The devil cannot withstand the word of God. And that is why it's to our advantage if we let the word of God richly dwell in us. When Satan came to tempt the Lord Jesus, the Lord resisted the devil using the word of God. You see, there's no better weapon than God's word. We are not to argue with the devil. We are not to be petrified of the devil. Oh no, he's a defeated foe. And we are certainly not to agree with the devil. We have been commanded to resist the devil. Nehemiah refused to flee when he was threatened. Instead, he replied the enemies of progress by focusing on God and the work God has given him. And God gave him the victory. So when we focus on God and we focus on the word of God, that is how we resist the devil. James 4:7 is a very popular verse. James 4:7. Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. To desist from evil is to resist the devil. If they are asking you to join in and be one of us, everybody sing Kumbaya, we're Buddhists, Confucius, or whatever, Hindus, everybody, we are together in the same boat, you say no, 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 no. To desist from evil is to resist the devil. How can we recognize our eternal enemy, the devil? Number one, he appears peaceful. Satan puts peace as a front. It's a facade until you disagree with his ideas. When you disagree with his ideas, then you know that that peace is not. He applies persecution. Satan openly antagonizes a believer to frustrate that believer. He advances prostitution. Satan silently works like a leaven, like yeast, to destroy a believer's spiritual integrity by introducing rewards that will compromise the believer's biblical stand. How can we overcome our eternal enemy? Resist. We should counter devil's advocacy by focusing on the Word of God. As disciples of Jesus, the Holy Spirit has now exposed the three enemies we have: the flesh, our natural inclination to sin, the world's godless values, and the devil. And the Holy Spirit has exposed through these lessons how we can identify each of them and what we must do to overcome each one of them. It's not a one-size-fits-all. No. This is why we need to become Bible students, so as to know what weapon we should employ when each battle arises. Whatever happens, we are not to make marriages with satanic doctrines, worldly values, and ungodly beliefs. We are not. An unbeliever is not at war with the devil. Oh no. Why? Because he's already in the devil's cage. That's really sad, isn't it? Because the devil is a cruel master. He's a bad, bad master. He's a bad devil. The end for such a sinner is a disastrous habitation in a conscious state. You will see, you can smell, you can hear, you can remember, you can feel. All your senses will be heightened. But in the lake of fire, without any parole, that's a terrible jail to go to. Now, God didn't make that for you. No. Every way God had punished human beings for their errors, God always gives a break. But when God created a fire without parole, the Bible says it was meant for the devil and his angels. You see, it's not for human beings. But people choose to go there by refusing to release their lives to Jesus. However, it is not too late for you. If you are watching me right now, you can change that course. Because a minute from now, you don't know what's going to happen. A minute from now will be too late. Because every one of us, we are one heartbeat away from eternity. One heartbeat. Just like, if it stops, you'll say, that person is dead. That's it. If you would like to escape the evil in your future without Jesus, now you want Jesus to be in your life, there is a link coming. Because if Jesus is not in your future, if he's not your Lord here, he's not going to be in your future. And that's disastrous. But if you want to change that, the link that is coming up, please follow that link. We'll meet you there. All right? Father, thank you. Thank you for the shed blood at Calvary that delivered us from the grip of death, hell, sin, and Satan. Oh Lord, help us to stand. Holy Spirit, continue to keep us in the narrow road. Make us strong, Lord, we pray. For our brothers and sisters who are living in countries where Christianity is a crime, Father, we pray for a special grace for them to stand. And as many who are going to want to know Jesus' page, Father, meet with them in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. I will see you next week, only if Jesus has not split the sky open.